الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا وداعيا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجا منيرا صلى الله عليه وسلم. عباد الله، أولا أوصيكم بتقوى الله عز وجل، لأنه يقول: ومن يتق الله يجعل له مخرجا ويرزقه من حيث لا يحتسب. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. We begin in the name of Allah, the most merciful, the most kind. All praise belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, the Lord of the universe. We send peace and blessings upon his last and final messenger, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we begin with a reminder of taqwa, of being conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of being mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of being aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of being fearful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of being hopeful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of having this state of mind that with every action we do, we think of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the ayah that I quoted in the beginning of my khutbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. He says that whoever has taqwa of Allah, whoever is able to achieve this consciousness of Allah, this mindfulness of Allah, whoever is able to achieve that, to have that, يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will always find a way out for that individual. No matter the person's situation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will find a solution for that individual. وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. And He will provide for that individual. Not only will Allah find a solution for that individual, but He will provide that solution in methods, in ways that that person cannot calculate. لا يحتسب, is not able to calculate it, is not able to understand that this is the method that Allah would have provided the solution through. That this is the method that Allah would have took me out of this situation. لا يحتسب, that he is not able to calculate that, he is not able to understand that. So we begin with these two very important reminders that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us to have taqwa, to be conscious. And that Allah promises those that have that taqwa to get their back and to make sure that they are never in need. In today's khutbah, I want to talk a little bit about one of the most important current issues that is going on. And that is the humanitarian crisis in Yemen. And what we are seeing in Yemen today is not only a regional war, not only some issues that are going on in that specific region in terms of their politics, in terms of back and forth and fractions or whatnot, but they are also facing a famine. They are also facing one of the worst cases of COVID-19. And I'm sure many of you have seen the statistics and seen the pictures, and seen what is going on, and those that are suffering, especially the innocent parties that have nothing to do with whatever politics are taking place in the region. And in today's khutbah, I don't want to specifically highlight just the misery, but I want to talk about Yemen from the tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, from the beautiful Yemen that is presented to us by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because we are too used to seeing Yemen suffering. We are too used to seeing Yemen as a country, as a land of need. Whereas the importance of this land, the importance of this people, the connectedness of these individuals and this land to our tradition is immense. So much so that there's a hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says that the first people to drink from the Kawthar, from this well of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's in Jannah, will be the Ahle Yemen. Why did the Prophet make such a statement? What is the value of this land, of this people? Why is it so connected to our religion? And that is what we want to take a look at. Not only the aspects that they are suffering, not only the perspective that Yemen is always in need of help, but there was a time and a place where Yemen, the Ahle Yemen, the people of Yemen, the land of Yemen, was one of the greatest supporters of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was the backbone of the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And even before that, to the call of Prophet Ibrahim, to the monotheistic call that Prophet Ibrahim preached, and all of this is preserved in the hadith literature that we have. So let us look at a few hadith and try to understand Yemen and the people of Yemen from the value that is given to it by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In a hadith narrated by Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أتاكم أهل اليمن أضعف قلوبا وأرق أفئدة الفقه يمان والحكمة يمانية. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, as narrated on the authority of Abu هريرة رضي الله عنه, he says that here come the people of Yemen and their hearts are soft. Their hearts are soft, meaning in terms of their care, in terms of their attentiveness, in terms of their connection to the religion. And it continues, the hadith says, al-fiqhu yamanin, that this understanding, the concept of fiqh, the concept of legal theory, the concept itself is yamanin. He attributes it to the land of Yemen. He attributes it to Yemen. And this is not to say that the only fiqh that there is in Yemen, but rather to show us the value, the hikmah, the wisdom. He says, al-fiqhu yamanin. These are the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He continues and he says, wal-hikmatu yamaniyatun. He says, and wisdom is yamaniya, is Yemeni. These are the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In another narration by Abu Hurairah radiallahu an also, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, al-imanu yamanin. And this is a very preserved hadith in our tradition. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, al-iman, iman. This concept that we learn since we are a young child, that al-iman, this concept of iman, yamanin, he attributes it to Yemen to show us that iman is not limited to Yemen. But the true iman, this quality, this attribute of iman, is like the iman of Yemen, is like the iman that is found amongst the Ahle Yemen, amongst the people of Yemen. The companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, some of his strongest supporters were from the descendants of Yemen. The Ansar of Medina were from the descendants of Yemen. That there's connection to Ahle Yemen is strong within our tradition. That it is not only a land that belongs to certain people, but the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in a very famous dua that he made, he says, Allahumma barik lana fi yamanina. He says, oh Allah, bless our Yemen. Our Yemen. Not bless Yemen. He doesn't say, oh Allah, bless Yemen, bless this land of Yemen. Give it barakah. But rather he attributes it to himself. And this is another hadith as well, that A person came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he actually said that I am Yemeni, and this goes back to his foster mother. The connection of this land of Ahl Yemen, of the people of Yemen, is strong within our tradition. And it is not only that we look at Yemen as a place that needs help, but we need to understand, going back to the tradition, that Yemen was one of the first lands. Yemen was one of the first, or the people of Yemen were the first to give that support to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says that Allahumma barik lana fi yamanina. Oh Allah, bring barakah, or give barakah to our Yemen. And today we make that dua as well, in the footsteps, in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that oh Allah, ya Allah, Allahumma barik lana fi yamanina, that oh Allah, bring this barakah to our Yemen. Because what we see going on in Yemen, what we see going on in Yemen, it is not something that we can be silent about. It is not something that we can turn a blind eye to. It is not something that we can simply scroll by in our feed and try not to look at it, because those pictures make us feel some type of way. But the true sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to give that support, is to do whatever is in our ability to bring about change to Ahli Yemen, to the people of Yemen. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us that ability, to revive our spirit from within our tradition, to give that support to those that are suffering the most in Yemen. In the Quran and throughout the Quran, this beautiful land of Yemen is mentioned over and over again. And there are many regions of the Muslim world that owe their original da'wah, that owe their original iman, the concept of the religion, back to this land of Yemen. One of the most populated Muslim countries is Bangladesh, and that land that surrounds it. And the person that brought the da'wah there, there's two narrations about him. That Shah Jalal, he's either from Turkey or he's from Yemen. The lands of Malaysia, Indonesia, these lands that are present, the most populated Muslim countries on earth. The da'wah, where did it come from? The land of Yemen. The traders that went from Yemen. The coast of Africa, the da'wah that went there, where did it come from? This is Islamic History 101. Where did it come from? The land of Yemen. That there is so much barakah, there is so much connectivity towards iman, towards the religion. That these stories that we tell, that Islam was seen, or the traders, the business people, they went and people saw their character. Where were these individuals from? They were from the land of Yemen. That Allahumma barik lana fi yamanina. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's dua will be the end to the first part of this khutbah. O Allah, bless our land of Yemen. Udu'u Allah li wa lakum. Use this time for silent prayer. Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. قرأ ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قول عز وجل وأذن في الناس بالحج يأتوك رجالا وعلى كل ضامر يأتين من كل فج عميق فقال فقام إبراهيم عليه السلام فنادى فقال أيها الناس إن الله كتب عليكم الحج فحجوا وبلغ الله صوته إلى جميع الآفاق قال ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما فكان أهل اليمن هم أول من أجاب إبراهيم عليه السلام. A hadith narrated in the tafasir that are mentioned from Ibn Abbas, the greatest mufassir of the ummah, that the ayah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا, this ayah that was a command to Prophet Ibrahim that called the people towards Hajj. And this ayah is actually a very good example of the opening of the khutbah as well, the concept of taqwa and the concept of Allah bringing solutions in ways that a person cannot calculate. Because the story of Ibrahim is full of solutions in the method that Prophet Ibrahim himself could not calculate. Whether it be the fire, that Allah didn't bring down rain, but rather He changed the properties of the fire. And whether it be this call of Ibrahim. After Ibrahim alayhi salam, he built the Kaaba. And he was commanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah, وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ. And Allah says, يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا وَعَلَى كُلِّ ضَامِرٍ يَأْتِينَ مِنْ كُلِّ فَجٍ عَمِيقٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Prophet Ibrahim that, call the people for Hajj. Call the people for Hajj. And they will come to you from every corner of this globe. They will come to you from every corner of this globe. Now to truly understand that, because our understanding of Hajj is very different. We see every year millions of people going to Hajj. We see Hajj as the largest gathering. But going back to the time of Prophet Ibrahim, in the middle of the desert, nowhere near civilization, nobody existing in that area, nobody wanting to go to that area, non-developed desert, no cities, no towns, nothing in that area. And Allah tells Ibrahim, build this house. And Ibrahim builds that house. And Allah says, وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ. That call the people, call out the people for Hajj. Call out the people for Hajj. Now Ibrahim, who's here? Who am I going to call out to? And the hadith says that Ibrahim started to call out. And it says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made his voice heard throughout the globe. And today, even today, we respond to that call when we go to Hajj and we say, Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik. We are here, O Allah. That is a response to the call of Ibrahim, وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ, of this ayah. And in this hadith, this narration, Ibn Abbas says that the voice of Ibrahim, this call of Ibrahim was heard throughout the globe, and the first people to respond to that, the first people to respond to that, as mentioned by Ibn Abbas, was Ahl Yemen, was the people of Yemen. So this is even before Prophet Isa. This is even before Prophet Muhammad. This is at the time of Ibrahim. When Ibrahim began with this call, the first individuals that responded were Ahl Yemen. Why do you think the Prophet ﷺ said, Al-Imanu Yamanin? That Iman itself, that this truth is like that truth, like that Iman of Yemen. Because the people of Yemen, the Ahl Yemen, are always fighting for the truth, are always there for the truth, are always supporting the truth. And they make that effort that the Prophet ﷺ highlights in the ahadith. So now we must bring about this question, that what can we do as individuals to help the people of Yemen? And what can we do as Muslims? Because at the very least, they are our brothers and sisters. At the very least, they are part of this ummah. That what can we do to bring or to alleviate their pain and suffering? And there are a few things that most of us know, but the most important of them is to actually act upon them. Because we know all of the different routes that we can take. But without acting upon them and just having the theoretical knowledge of them is useless. Is useless. If there's no action, that theoretical knowledge has no benefit. We need to raise awareness as a unified body. And I don't know if many of you follow the legislation that goes on. But recently, they passed the legislation for our Uyghur brothers and sisters in China. The issue that was going on with the concentration camps. And that was something that the Muslim community across thought wouldn't take place. But it is the effort of individuals that constantly push and lobby and try to bring about that difference that it gets implemented. So we need that collective effort. And I know many of the young people especially are capable of that type of activism, are capable of dedicating certain time that they can give to organizations that are lobbying or to create petitions or whatnot. And that is something doable because we see the fruits of our struggle for our Uyghur brothers and sisters that recently just passed. And that's just the beginning. We still need to work on that. Another method is humanitarian aid. And what I want to highlight about this is be very careful where you send your money. Because there are a lot of organizations that are collecting but that are not operating on the ground there. So be very careful, do your research, do your homework, make sure you're donating to an organization that can get your money to the ground. And if you know somebody personally that you trust that can do that, go that route. But make sure you are putting some of your sadaqah, some of your zakat towards our brothers and sisters there. And like I said, the most important out of all of this is the action that we take. No matter how little that action is. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to act upon what we learn. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to implement the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to be from amongst those that are constantly fighting for justice, that are constantly trying to do what is right, even if it be against ourselves, even if it be against our families, even if our entire community is on the wrong side, we ask Allah to allow us to be on the right side. Allahumma ameen. Allahumma ighfir lana wa liwalidayna wa lilmuslimina wal muslimat al ahya'i minhum wal amwat innaka sami'ul mujibu ad-da'awat ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم وصل اللهم على سيدنا وحبيبنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أقم الصلاة.
So sufufakum. Guess I'm in the habit of saying straighten your rows, but inshallah stay where you are. Allahu Akbar. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. إذا زلزلت الأرض زلزالها وأخرجت الأرض أثقالها وقال الإنسان ما لها يومئذ تحدث أخبارها بأن ربك أوحى لها يومئذ يصدر الناس أشتاتا ليروا أعمالهم فمن يعمل مثقال ذرة خيرا يره ومن يعمل مثقال ذرة شرا يره. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. أرأيت الذي يكذب بالدين فذلك الذي يدع اليتيم ولا يحض على طعام المسكين فويل للمصلين الذين هم عن صلاتهم ساهون الذين هم يراءون ويمنعون الماعون. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله